Hey everyone, this is Richard.
And this is Linda.
Welcome to the Day Zero Gamer Infinite Live Show. This is show number 61 for January 14th, 2013. So I got the 2013 part right.
Yes.
Feel good about that.
Yeah, not bad. Only took you 1 week.
Yeah. Sucks about them nasty IT issues, huh?
Yeah, it happens.
Yeah. So apologies to those listening. Show is it's today. It's Monday.
Yeah.
Kind of odd.
We don't do that very often.
Yeah. Again, apologies, but we're here now, so that's good.
Yeah. Only 1 day off.
Yeah. Not bad. Have a good week?
Yes. Very good week. Busy, as always. But always squeezing some games in.
There you go.
And you?
I've just been freezing. It's been really cold.
Yes. It has been very cold.
Really, really cold.
Been but, cranking up the heater.
Yeah, I was going to say that, but I've been indoors, and I was going to say chilling, but, you know, like that's...
Heating.
Heating.
I don't know.
Yeah. Apart from that, I've just been playing games, too.
Awesome.
But yeah, Monday, so here we are. Tomorrow is new releases, so what's coming out?
Tuesday, January 15th. BioShock Ultimate Rapture Edition comes out for the 360 and PS3. And DMC Devil May Cry comes out for the 360 and PS3. And that's all I have to report this week.
Alrighty. So you said you were playing games, so what were you rocking?
Black Ops 2.
Nice.
Tetris Axis.
Nice.
Of course. And played some Halo 4 this week.
Awesome.
Yeah, that's all I have.
Cool. For me, Halo 4. Mm-hmm. Actually played some Black Ops 2 as well. And played some more Resident Evil Revelations.
Nice.
Yeah. So, fun stuff. Good times all around. And that was my week.
Awesome.
So, speaking of Resident Evil Revelations, due to some quote-unquote leaked achievements, looks like the game may see life on the Xbox 360. So that's from the 3DS to the 360. So the rumor for now is that the game's full title will be Resident Evil Revelations Unveiled Edition. Whoa. So, yeah, interesting stuff. I'm really stoked because, I mean, like I said, it's a really fun game. It's a really good game. And, I mean, right now I'm enjoying that on the 3DS. But if that does happen, I mean, hopefully we see some nice textures. I mean, essentially an HD overhaul. So
that would be cool.
I'm stoked. Hopefully it happens because, again... Great game. I'm enjoying the heck out of it. And it would be awesome to sit back on the couch. Well, I guess you could do that with the 3DS anyway, but I mean, play it on the big screen. So.
I know what you meant.
Yeah. All right, so moving along. So speaking of the 3DS, Pokemon X and Pokemon Y are heading to that handheld this October.
Awesome.
Next is, as we talked about on show 59, that whole Black Ops 2 Revolution DLC.
Mm-hmm.
It is indeed hitting the Xbox 360 January 29th, so that's pretty awesome. And along with those four competitive multiplayer maps and the zombie map, which we talked about, there's also a new weapon called the Peacekeeper. So it's a hybrid of an SMG and assault rifle, and a new mode called Turned, which is apparently a zombie mode that allows players to turn into zombies themselves.
That's cool.
Yeah. So we'll have to see how that plays, but that's pretty cool.
I like that.
Yeah, just a few days away, really. I mean, the 29th. Geez, right around the corner.
Yeah, no kidding.
So, good stuff. Next is LEGO Marvel Super Heroes. That was announced, which is going to be hitting stores this fall. So, another LEGO game. This time, the Marvel people. So, you got Iron Man and all those guys. So, that's going to be kind of cool.
Yeah, that sounds fun. Because, I mean, all the different heroes that you could use. That's going to be awesome. Can't wait to see that one.
Definitely. And on the flip side, this is the next little bit of news, on the DC side, I should say, two more fighters have been revealed for Injustice Gods Among Us. So we got Lex Luthor and Bane.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm very excited to see Bane.
Yeah, me too. Just having Bane in the game, that's really going to be cool.
That's exciting.
Yeah. Next up, Microsoft. So these guys, they showed off this new tech called IllumiRoom.
Yes.
Which is pretty insane. Essentially transforms the area around a user's TV into, I guess it's like an extension of the screen itself. So it looks pretty crazy. I mean, they have a video up. In fact, we'll put a link in the description. It kind of uses Kinect and a projector kind of together, because I'm saying kind of a whole bunch. It really does do that. It's not like a kind of. It actually uses Kinect and a projector. And basically, for what we know, it uses the Kinect to kind of scan the room, and then it modifies the projected visuals in real time. So that way, it doesn't have to like try to set it up itself first. It actually scans the room, and then it projects it according to how your room is laid out.
That looks pretty cool.
What was tripping me out is that, because you saw the video too, is the little bit that you see with Halo.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like the snow level. And then you see just like behind the TV, it's like snow falling.
Yeah.
See, that is awesome to me. I mean, it's one thing to have like an extended view where your screen is bigger and it's kind of like coming out of the edges of the TV and stuff. But to me, it would be fantastic to be playing Halo. I mean, I just said that. And you're playing on the snow level. You're playing on like a rainy weather type of stage or whatever. And you just get that vibe, that feeling around you where it's like it's enhancing the experience, really.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, if it was just a bigger screen, a bigger TV, or just using a projector instead of a TV would do the same job.
Mm-hmm.
But the way they did it, it's to engulf you in the world, which is really exciting.
Yeah. So I am totally stoked to see where Microsoft takes this and, of course, how much it's going to cost.
Oh, yeah.
And then which games or what type of media is going to support it, because, I mean, if only like 3 or 4 different things do it, then that's something. Hmm. But if they, for the next Xbox, for example, they make it so every single game is compatible in some way, that would be pretty awesome.
Yeah. We'll have to see. I'm very excited to see how they pull this off.
Yeah. And also, too, does it have to be a pitch black room? I mean, it has to be really dark, or can you have some ambient light? I mean, what's
the requirements there? That's true, because some projectors, just in general, the bulbs are so weak, you have to have a pitch dark room or a certain screen.
Yep.
So that's a good point, because if it's a better projector that's like totally awesome, it's going to be way more expensive.
Yeah, and then of course the bulbs too. I mean, as you know, those things are a fortune. So we'll have to see, like you said. We'll have to see what they do and how they pull it off, but it's exciting.
Exciting, yeah. Anytime anything new comes out, I mean, that's awesome. As long as they continue to innovate, I'm excited.
Yeah, same here. And let's see. Lastly, let's wrap up the news by going over 2 new special editions for 2 different games. So the first, Dead Island Riptide's Rigor Mortis Edition. So that's been announced for $79.99, and it includes a Dead Island Riptide Special Edition game, which includes a bunch of DLC content, a zombie hula girl bobble figure.
Hmm.
Yeah, so that's fun. Bloody zombie arm bottle opener magnet.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, you need one of those. A bungalow key with a branded wood keychain.
Okay.
Digital strategy map. And it's all packaged inside a Dead Island-themed replica suitcase.
Pretty cool.
Yeah, so, I mean, geez, all for $79.99. Pretty cool.
No, not bad.
Second one is Dead Space 3's Dev Team Edition. This one's pretty intense. It's limited to only 5,000 and is sold exclusively at EA's Official Gear online store. So you got to go there to get it, and only 5,000 are going to exist. So here's what it comes with. An 8-inch custom molded and painted polyresin black marker statue. 10-inch by 7-inch hinged aluminum data pad flipbook that features 9 sets of pages made up of framed PET sheets and printed cardstock backing pages.
That sounds interesting.
Yeah. Custom molded MedPack water bottle. Bound scaff jotter with Dr. Serrano's notes, which has 20 pages of Dead Space lore and some blank pages for personal entries. So you can make your own little, your notes about your discoveries and finds.
Yeah, I'm totally going to write inside of a collectible item.
Yeah, I know. See, I was reading that too, and I was like, yeah, I'm not going to do that, but that's cool. A set of 3 12-inch by 5-inch vintage-feeling scaff posters, which are printed on 80-pound paper. A set of 6 vintage Peng postcards. 96-page mini art book. And it's all packaged inside of a tin crate, which includes a metal plate listing that edition's number stamped directly onto it.
Very cool.
Yeah. Pretty sweet. So here's the thing. EA is offering 2 different versions of that Dev Team Edition. So the first one, $160. And it includes everything I just listed, plus a copy of course, the game itself.
Mm-hmm.
And you get to choose the 360, PS3, or PC. And if you do that, for that 160, you get all that stuff, the game, and a bunch of DLC, which you get the First Contact bundle, which includes the First Contact suit and Negotiator weapon, and Witness the Truth bundle, which includes the Witness the Truth suit and Tactical Evangelizer weapon. So
that's
all that,
pretty cool.
160, you got the game and all that stuff. Pretty sweet. The second one, it's $100. So $60 less. Includes everything I listed, minus the game and the DLC.
I think that's pretty cool.
Yeah, I think so too. Because, I mean, the purpose behind that is for those folks that want all that stuff, but they want the game at midnight, or they can get the game at a better deal, or, I mean, there's a pre-order bonus at a different store. You can still get all that collector's edition, that dev team edition stuff, just without the game.
Yeah, I like that a lot.
Yeah.
Because that always happens. It's like, you know, this one store has some DLC or some pre-order item
yeah.
that you can have with your game, but they're not doing collector's edition.
Yeah.
So if you get the collector's edition elsewhere, well, you just bought the game twice.
Absolutely.
So
absolutely.
I think it's really smart that they did that.
Two different prices, but a lot of good stuff.
Reasonable, too.
Yeah, not bad. And we'll have a link to the site that you can order that from in the description, too.
Awesome.
And that is the news. Good stuff.
Yeah, a lot of stuff going on.
Yeah. Whew. All right. So, on to the retro game. So the game for this week, Mortal Kombat 2.
Mortal Kombat.
I feel like we've done that before.
Yeah.
Probably the other retro game.
Well, can't blame me for being consistent.
That's true.
I seriously think about that every time I hear Mortal Kombat.
I know.
I hear the voice inside my head.
And the music.
Yes.
In my head.
Of course. The music has to come along with it.
Yeah. And I think we said that same exact thing last time, too. Oh, well. That was a good song. It did a good job. It did a really good job. Anyway. All right. So Mortal Kombat 2. So I guess I'll start. So Mortal Kombat 2 is pretty much where Mortal Kombat got serious for me. I mean, I loved Mortal Kombat 1. I talked about it. I had it on the PC. But Mortal Kombat 2, at the time, it wasn't available for the PC in any of the stores near my house or the ones that I went to. So there was no way for me to buy it. So the only place I could play it was the arcade.
Wow.
So obviously, as we've talked about time and time again, in the arcade, at least back in the day, typically there are other people there.
Yeah.
At least for fighting games. I mean, you walk up and sure, you may be by yourself, but in maybe 30 seconds or a couple minutes, somebody will, of course, show up, challenge you. And if you're not good, then they're just going to take your quarter.
Yeah.
Kind of sucks when you want to get good and you want to practice.
It's hard to try to practice at the arcade.
Yeah.
Not a great environment for that.
Yeah, and that's exactly what I tried to do. So that's why when I say it got serious for me, that's what I was trying to do. I was trying to practice, and it was rough. It was definitely rough, I have to say.
Wow. For me, it's the same thing I said about the first Mortal Kombat. Love the live-action graphics. But Mortal Kombat 2, it looked so much better.
Yeah, it did.
What can you do with live-action digitized graphics, you know?
Yeah.
But it was still so cool back then.
It was really cool. In fact, I mean, looking at it now, even today, it still holds up. Well, sort of. Kind of. I mean, it looks good. I think it looks good. I mean, for me, yeah, I have to say, I do like the graphics of Mortal Kombat 2. I don't know. It's just this kind of style. Of course, I've talked about it. I love Sub-Zero. And Mortal Kombat 2 is where I became, like, super obsessed with him because his costume, like, well, all the ninjas, I mean, Scorpion and Reptile, they looked awesome. Like, I love the crosshatch pattern on the suit.
Mm-hmm.
The thick black outline, the details on the mask. I mean, they just looked great. And you can actually see all that stuff versus, like, in Mortal Kombat 1, it's kind of blurry.
Yeah.
Yeah. It looks, it's like a real
use your
person.
Imagination.
Yeah, exactly. It's, I mean, it's a real person, but it's kind of like, is that a cartoon body? I mean, what's going on there? So, yeah, Mortal Kombat 2 had much better detail. But Sub-Zero, geez, I loved his ability to freeze the ground.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that was cool. Just a little puddle. Well, it wasn't a puddle. It was like an ice. Well, frozen ice puddle, sort of.
Yeah. That's,
yeah.
I love that.
Yeah, that was awesome. And So I was at the arcade, and I really thought it was awesome. I thought it was so awesome that I kept trying to do it, and I kept doing it over and over and over. And I focused so much on trying to do that and trying to, like, lure somebody into it that I always got my butt kicked.
Hmm.
Every time.
I know how that feels.
Yeah. It's like I was so stubborn because I thought that move was so neat, and I loved just freezing the ground, and the dude is, like, slipping and just kind of, like, sliding towards you. I just kept trying to do it over and over. And eventually, these veteran players who were really good, they're just, no, that's not going to work. And then
Noob.
They just, yeah, exactly. And then they tore me up. But, yeah, Mortal Kombat 2 is really nice looking. Definitely an improvement over the first one.
Yes, totally. I remember, just like how you loved Sub-Zero, I had fun trying out Katana.
Oh, yes.
So I grew up watching a lot of Chinese movies, and one of my favorite weapons is using a fan. Like, you know, there are other weapons, swords, a flute, but fans, when I was younger, I thought were so awesome. So my mom bought me these fans, and I would, like, you know, fling them around, and I'd actually, like, try to, like, chop people's head. Well, not people, but pretend people's heads off by throwing them and flinging them across the room and trying to get it to spin like a boomerang. So it was awesome to see Katana fight with fans.
Yeah, that was exactly what she was doing.
Yeah. Couldn't get fans to do that in real life, though.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean,
but that was probably a good thing, considering I was very young.
You probably could if you, like, attach blades or razor blades or something to it, but you know. Yeah.
And get ones that actually stay open.
Yeah.
Ones that you don't have to hold open.
That's true.
Yeah. That could become very dangerous.
Yeah.
But yes, I actually thought that was really cool because it was like, whoa, that's like my favorite weapon. I mean, you really don't usually see fans as weapons in fighting games, you know? That's like not a typical weapon that mm-hmm. people use.
Yeah.
So it was pretty awesome to see that. I mean, like, I loved it.
Yeah.
Wasn't good at it, but I loved it.
Yeah, Katana was cool. Definitely cool. She was neat.
But Scorpion's still my favorite.
Yeah.
And what else? Oh, the Babalities and Friendships.
Oh, jeez, I forgot all about those.
Okay, that is like the coolest thing ever.
Yeah, that is right. I forgot. Yeah, that's when they started. Yeah, Babalities and Friendships.
I thought it was so weird, but so cool. You know, because it's like, what the heck is this?
Yeah.
Who, at the end of fighting, you know, you turn the other person into a baby.
Yeah.
I mean, like, that is so random. Who comes up with that? But,
yeah.
I thought that was really cool, though.
Yeah, and in fact, I mean, this is where they had multiple fatalities and different stage fatalities, too.
Never quite got those right. But, yes, that's awesome. I mean, how can you have Mortal Kombat without fatalities?
Of course. Of course. But going back to the Babalities and Friendships, I mean, at first, everybody wants to see the fatalities.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that was how, at least with the arcade that I was playing at, everybody was just, oh, yeah, I'm going to take you down. And then, boom, they knock out a fatality. And it's like, wow, okay. But then once people figured out that there's Babalities and then Friendships, it was like, I'm going to humiliate you. Instead of just killing you, I'm going to do one of those. And, yeah, it was pretty awesome.
Very awesome. I love that they added all that. Made the game really fun. And I spend a lot of time trying to practice the Babalities and the Fatalities. I was just never good at it. I'd always get, like, the last button wrong.
Yeah, the timing was just, the window was really short.
Oh,
to be
that
able to
too.
Pull those off,
oh,
so.
My gosh.
It was frustrating. And if you're not exactly at the right position, you know, if it's like sweep distance or whatever, it's like, oh, it's embarrassing too, because at the arcade, you know, you can pull it off. I mean, you've done it yourself, but then there you are trying to input the commands and then you fail.
Yeah.
That's
and
even
you just, like knock them over.
Oh yeah. It's pretty,
that's very embarrassing.
That's pretty bad. Yeah. I feel, I remember some guys that I was playing against, and then they would do that. Like, they'd beat me and I'm just like, ah, crap, that sucks. And then they try to do a fatality but fail. And then they're like, they're getting ripped to pieces by all the people watching because it's, it like backfired. They try to humiliate me, but in a way, they just did it to themselves. So,
yeah.
Yeah, that was fun. It's good stuff.
It's a plus to not winning.
Yeah, yeah. As long as you run into one of those people. Yeah, geez, the stage fatalities. I loved.
Oh yeah.
That my favorite one was the Mortal Kombat 2, the pit, because the first one you knock them into the spikes. Well, this one, I don't know if you remember, but you knock them off the bridge, and then the camera changes and it shows like directly like above them, mm-hmm. and so you see them falling and then splat right onto the ground. So at the time it was pretty brutal because they're falling and then they hit the cement, and of course things are squirting out, but. Yeah, I thought that was pretty awesome. Instead of just, oh, there they go. There's like the side profile of them and then boom onto a spike. This one, they actually changed the camera. So pretty cool.
Yeah, they got all elaborate.
Mm-hmm.
It's always a nice sign.
Yeah.
That's like awesome. I love the stage fatalities.
Yeah. And those are awesome too, because to see somebody pull that off, it's almost unexpected a little bit, because then you see them like uppercut you or whatever, and you're like, what's going on? And then boom, into whatever that environmental situation is.
Mm-hmm.
So pretty cool. Definitely yeah. Cool. And that's really, I think that's all I got to say. Love the game.
Always fun.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we wanted to thank everyone who took the time to listen to the show. Be on the lookout next Sunday for show number 62. Special thanks to Ronald Jenkins for providing Disorganized Fun for the Infinite Lives show theme song.
Have a great week, guys.